It's a pleasure to be here this morning. We have a PowerPoint slide up that says, "Welcome, we're glad you're here." And that is true. You are welcome, and we are glad you're here. There's nothing more important that we could be doing today, right now, than what we are about to do. We are about to enter into our worship service as the body of Christ to give God all the praise and glory that he deserves. And I'm excited to be here. I'm looking forward to worshiping God. But I'm glad that you're here as well for us to worship together. When I see your love for the Lord and when I see your faithfulness, that inspires me, that encourages me, that motivates me. So welcome. We're glad you're here. If you came in this morning and you want to take the Lord's Supper, we have Lord's Supper packets prepared on the back table over here. If you did not pick one of those up, please feel free right now to get up and go get the Lord's Supper that you need for later on in our worship service. By way of announcements, Carrie Ann's baby shower is coming up on Saturday, July 31st, this coming Saturday. So let's keep that in mind. This week, the teens have a devotional at the Roberts House on Tuesday night at 7 p.m. They also are meeting here at the church building on Saturday from 6 to 10 p.m. For games and activities and fun. So please make plans to participate in those events this week. Shauna Turner and J.C. Piffner have been leading a ladies' Bible study. And the next one is scheduled for August 15th at the Piffner's house. And so, ladies, please mark that on your calendars and make plans to participate in that. I do know that several families of the congregation are going to be traveling in the very near future. And so we want to keep them in our prayers for safe travels. And I've been informed that Beverly Stutz's son, Zach, tore his Achilles and is going to be having surgery this week, and she asked that we pray for him. So let's keep Zach in our prayers, specifically for his surgery that is coming up this week. And with that in mind, let us go to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, you are the supreme ruler of the universe. And Father, we know that there is nothing impossible for you to do. And so, Father, we bring before you at this time Zach and the surgery that he's going to have this week. Father, we pray for you to bless him and heal his body and oversee everything that happens in this surgery. Father, we pray that the surgeons will do the right things and that there will be no problems and no complications, and that he will be restored to his health. We just pray for you to protect him and bless him during this surgery. Father, we pray for those who are traveling that you will have grace upon them and protect them in their travels. May they be able to enjoy their time away with family and friends and the fun activities that they have planned and bring them back safely to us, Father. We just pray for you to bless them. Lord, we know that there is no one like you. You are the Holy One and you are set apart from all other beings. You are worthy of all praise, all glory, and all honor. And Father, we are excited to be gathered together to worship you this morning. We pray, Father, that we will set aside worldly distractions and concerns and be able to focus our hearts and our minds completely on you this morning, that we might worship you with all of our hearts and give you the glory that you deserve. May you be pleased with our worship service this morning. Father, I pray that you be with those who lead in worship to guide their thoughts and help them lead us in a way that will be pleasing to you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay, we're going to sing hymn number 4 today. That's hymn number 4 if you prefer to use a book. To God be the glory.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done, so loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear it.
Now, if you would please turn to hymn number 684. That's hymn number 684. That's Nearer, My God, to Thee. We're going to sing hymn number 324. It's Alas and Did My Savior Bleed? And that'll be our song to prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper.
Alas and did my Savior bleed? And did my Savior
this time we want to remember our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. As we do that, I want to read from Romans chapter 5, verse 6 and following. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one might even dare to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Let's pray for the bread. Our Father in heaven, how great you are. Father, we praise you for your majesty. We praise you for your wisdom. We praise you for your plan. We praise you for Jesus. And we are so grateful for your Son, Jesus. Father, we are a sinful people. And Father, we trust in Jesus for our salvation. Father, we pray at this time that you be with us as we remember Christ. Father, be with each of those who partake of this bread. Father, bless them as they do so. Father, bless us as we remember Jesus. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue with our remembrance of Christ as we pray for the fruit of the vine. Please pray with me. Our Father in heaven, we are so grateful for Jesus and his sacrifice. And at this time, as we partake of the cup, we just pray that you bless us in doing so. Father, we pray that we do so in a manner that is acceptable to you and pleasing. Father, we do ask that you bless this cup and that you bless each of us who partake. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, we want to give thanks for our weekly contribution. You can place your contribution in the box in the rear or do so online. Instructions are in the bulletin for that purpose. It was very important to Paul that a contribution be taken up for the saints in Jerusalem. And he encouraged all the churches in Galatia and Macedonia and throughout the region that he had preached the gospel to take this collection up. And it was very important that that collection be done so in a manner that was appropriate. And he gave us instructions about how to do that, and we have embraced those instructions as a guide to help us understand how to contribute, how to give back to God, financially that is. And he makes this point. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one of us must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Let's pray for our contribution. Father, we thank you so much for the blessings in this life. We acknowledge that everything we have comes from you. And every good and perfect gift that we have is a blessing And we understand a responsibility to give back to you, and we want to do so in a manner that's cheerful. We want to do so in a manner that honors you. And we ask that you be with those who administer our funds, that they be handled properly and that they be distributed properly. And we are so anxious and so grateful for this opportunity to give back. And Father, we just pray that you bless each of those who give and that you continue to bless us so that we might continue to work in your kingdom. Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity. We pray that you bless these funds. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you're using your hymn books, please mark hymn number 852. That'll be our song for after our lesson. Our song before our lesson is hymn number 587. That's Sing and Be Happy. If the skies above you are gray, you are feeling so blue. If your cares and burdens seem great, all the whole day through, there's a silver shines in the heavenly land. Look by faith and see it, my friend. Trust in his promises grand. Sing and you'll be happy today. Press along to the goal. Trust in him who leadeth the way. He is keeping your soul. Let the world know where you belong. Look to Jesus and pray. Sorrow and pain. There are others living in sin, blessed with earthly gain. Take new courage, we cannot tell what the morrow may bring. When the dark clouds vanish away, then your heart truly can see. Sing and you'll be happy today. Press along to the goal.
Scripture reading today will be Ephesians 2, 17. And he came and preached peace to you who are far off and peace to those who are near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens and saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit.
Good morning. We had this problem last week, and I'm just going to move it, and if I mess things up. Good morning. One clarification really quick for Shauna and JC's Bible study that they're doing together. It is going to begin on August 15th at 4 o'clock at our house. And it really is, the design is it's geared for the younger girls and younger women with some of the older women, some teaching some of these class and also teaching some everyday things, which is good for them to know. And so while it is geared toward that age group, any and all of the women are invited to be a part of that. And I really encourage you to mark your calendars for this and be a part of this. They've done a lot of work to put it together to have people come and do this. And so if you are available for that, I would highly recommend you coming here, and you can just park right here in the parking lot and walk right over to our house. And it will be, you'll be encouraged by it, and you'll be learning a lot from it. So please make those plans for those, for you ladies to be a part of that. You know, oftentimes when we are talking to someone for the first time and we're trying to get to meet them, you know, we ask questions, like in particular here, you know, in the church building, we have new people here and we ask questions, you know, we ask names, right? And then you ask, oh, what? Where are you from? Right, everybody, that's usually where we at. Where are you from? And what we're trying to do, of course, is we're trying to get to know them. We're trying to talk and have conversations with them. But also we're trying to, you know, once you ask these questions, you're hoping that a conversation ensues, right? Where you can talk more and get to know them more, you know. And so, you know, they say, hey, where are you from? Oh, we're from Missouri. I got nothing. Well, you guys probably like the Kansas City Chiefs, right? Yeah. Now, I know there's a lot of Missouri people out here, so I know I'm going to hear this afterwards. The Kansas City Chiefs, of course, you know, oh, yeah, great, you love the Chiefs, that's great. Yeah, they won the Super Bowl 2 years ago. They didn't win last year, yes. You like football, so you like sports, you know, you talk about it, you're trying to, like, then you can, you know, you can provide some sympathy when they say, well, we're also Royals fans, Kansas City Royals fans. We can, you know, relate there and have, because the drought that the Rockies are in right now, but it's not quite like the Royals. But, you know, you're trying to find out some more information. You might ask about, you know, a lot of people read books. They have different movies, you know. Drew's not here this morning, but I was thinking about Drew Guest this morning. If you want to talk to Drew Guest, just bring up any movie, and then he'll talk to you for hours about movies. He loves and is passionate about movies. Oh, you can relate to him on that level. You try to find things that you can relate to so you can build kind of rapport, a conversation, and then maybe even a relationship where you can talk about these things more in the future, where you can talk about the different things, the likes, the hobbies, the places in which you grew up in, the places that you've been to, the places that you know, and the people that you might know in common. And all that happens because you're trying to find those things in common. Well, God provides some things, some commonalities that, of course, are above all of these things that we've just discussed here. There are some tremendous things in which God has given to us, has provided for us, and wants us to be reminded of these things, which are far more important to our unity and how we relate to each other than sports, than books we might read, movies that we might be interested in, or any hobbies. And we find that in Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, we've been looking at verse 4 through 6, and we looked at the idea of one body. And the next thing we have there is one spirit, the one spirit. These things are fundamental facts to the unity found in Christ. These are things in which we can draw back to when maybe we might be struggling in other areas. We can come back to these things and understand that we are united and we can relate because we are part of the one body. We are part of the one spirit. We have the one spirit. We have our one Lord. We have one God. We have one hope. We have all these things in common, which should create incredible bonds for those of us in Christ. And so sometimes, often the conversation that is left out in these things as we're trying to get one another is how we can relate as God's children. God's children, being blessed to be God's children in the unity that is found in there. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and or your Bible apps, turn to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, and we're going to kind of look a little bit here at some of the places that Paul talks about here with the idea of one spirit. So look at Ephesians chapter 4, and let me just read here from verse 1. Verse 1 and following, chapter 4, verse 1 and following. It says, "Therefore I, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness and patience, showing tolerance for one another in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body, and there is one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all." And so we see here in this first few verses there that there is some things, and we looked at these characteristics, these qualities in which we need to strive to possess in order to preserve the unity found in the Spirit that's found with peace. Okay, I want to go back there and look now the commonality that they have found back in chapter 1. So look in Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1. I want to point out here really quickly here in verse 1. It says, "To the saints who are at Ephesus and who are faithful in Christ Jesus." And so this is another word that we might call the disciples of Christ. Those people who are members of the body of Christ. Those that are Christians. Those that have been saved. Those who are in Christ are called the saints, those who have been set apart. And so this idea here is we want to make sure that we understand who he is talking to here when he says these things. So then drop down to verse 13, still speaking to these saints. He says, "In him you also, you saints who are at Ephesus, you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise, who is given as a pledge of our inheritance with a view to the redemption of God's own possession to the praise of his glory." So for those of us who are in Christ, as we see there in Ephesians 1, verses 3 and following, those who are in Christ, those who have the spiritual blessings, one of those spiritual blessings is that we've been sealed with the Holy Spirit. And we have that in common with one another. We have that one Spirit that has been given to us that we are sealed with. And this seal, which is the Holy Spirit, is the pledge. It is the down payment. Because guess what? We all needed that down payment. We all need it. There is not one person in here that didn't need that, that doesn't need that. One of the great things about Romans, one of the themes is the great equalizer. Romans is the great equalizer because Romans tells us that we're all in sin and that we all have the offering of Jesus and we all can be saved. There is no one that is greater or lesser than the other. We all need that down payment, that Holy Spirit, that pledge. And so we've all been given that pledge. Well, it says the Holy Spirit of promise. Now turn with me, hold your place there in Ephesians chapter 1, 2, 3, and 4, wherever your bookmarker. My 1, 2, 3, and 4 is all on the same page for me, so I don't have to flip pages back. But turn with me to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. Let me point out something here. And as you know, in Acts chapter 2, or as maybe many of you know, some of you may not know, in Acts chapter 2, Peter is speaking to some Jewish people there that are gathered there for a feast, and he is preaching about Christ, preaching about Jesus who has just resurrected and just ascended to heaven. And so he's basically telling him, guys, the guy that you just killed, that was the Son of God. That was the Son of David. That was the King. That was the Messiah, the one that we've been waiting for. You are guilty of crucifying him or participating with that. So in verse 36, he says, therefore, let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. And so in verse 37, he says, now when they heard this, that is the men of Israel, from verse 22, now when they heard this, they were pierced to the heart, they felt the shame, they felt the guilt, and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, repent, and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now look at verse 39, for the promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call to himself. So look at that, verse 39. For the promise, what is the promise? The promise that was just given to them, given by Peter. He said, what do you do? Well, I promise that if you repent and you are baptized, you will receive the forgiveness of your sins and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise that he just presented to the people, he says, it's not only just for you, but it's for others, it's for your children. And what he means by children, he's not talking, about our small little children as a young age. He's not using that in that way. He's using it with the concept of the next generation, your children, your children's children. And not only that, but those who are far off, those that are beyond here, Jerusalem. We know that Jesus told the apostles to go out into Jerusalem, Judea, and all Samaria, and into the remotest part of the world. And so that is that far off that promise is given to, that promise is presented. So when we get to Ephesians chapter 1, so turn back to Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13, it says, in him you also, after listening to the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, having also believed, you were sealed in him with the Holy Spirit of promise. Of promise. They were promised that they would receive this. The promise of the Holy Spirit. Who is, what is his work there? In this text, it says, he's given as a pledge of our inheritance with a view to the redemption of God's own possession to the praise of his glory. It is his. We have been reserved by God, and the Holy Spirit is kind of like, the other day we were out shopping, and we wanted to put some stuff on hold, and so they asked us for our name. And so we put our name, and they wrote it down there, and they stuck the tape onto the clothes, and they held it there, and so it was reserved for us. So in somewhat of a similar fashion, God has placed his Holy Spirit upon us, and it says that we are God's, that we are his, that we are reserved for him, and that's the Holy Spirit in which the saints, we as Christians, all possess. So when you think about the struggles that we might find, remember what he's talking about here earlier in chapter 4. It's we need to be show humility. We need to preserve the peace. We need to, in Philippians chapter 2, we need to show affection and compassion. Do not merely look out for your own interests, but look out for the interests of others. These things we need to do because we also need to keep in mind, one, we are the same body, but two, we all have that same down payment, that same pledge, that same seal that says we are God's. We are his children. So when we have disagreement, when we have argument, when we have fights, one of the last things I think that we really kind of consciously think of is, this is a brother or sister in Christ. This is a brother or sister who has been sealed with the Holy Spirit from God. And I imagine if we thought more along those lines, our interactions might change. Don't you think? Don't you think that we know it, but we need to then live it in how we interact with one another. And that's part of what Paul's point here is how the church works together. And these are the fundamental facts that we need to come back together to realize that we all have and possess. So then, again, the idea of verse 4 there in chapter 4, there is one body and there is one spirit. So then also, look with me at chapter 2. Chapter 2, and starting in, let's start in verse 17. This is part of the passage of which Ryland read this morning. Ephesians 2, verse 17, it says, "And he came and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to those who were near. For through him we have both access in one spirit to the Father. So then we are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and are of God's household." This idea here at verse 18 of access is that we have been granted access. If you think about it, in oftentimes in the ancient times, or even right now, if you were to go and knock on the White House door, well, let me back up. If you were to go and knock on the gate of that surrounding the White House, would you have access to the president? None of us in here, at least to my knowledge, are going to be able to have access to the president of the United States. Maybe you don't even want to have access to the president of the United States, but that's a whole nother discussion. But we're not going to have access to the president. We can't go and access, or we're not going to be granted access to the president. Just like we wouldn't be granted access to a lot of other leaders or people in this world, we don't have that access to them. We're just not, we just don't have the qualifications, we don't just know the right people, or we're not in the right positions. But we can't do that. And oftentimes in ancient times, kings were not approachable by just anyone. And you had to be granted access to approach the king. And so we think of who? We think of Esther. We think of Esther, right? Where it was not heard of for someone to go and approach the king without them getting permission, let alone a woman going before the king, even though she was the queen. So she did not have that access. Now, fortunately, God was looking, and she went and she saved millions of people because of her courage to go before the king, and the king granted her that access at that point, rather than, which it was in his right, to take her out and kill her because of that. But this is something else that we have in common with this one spirit. While we may not have access to the president, while we may not have access to the kings that we might find in this world, maybe you don't even have access to some of the popular people that we look up to in the sports and in different world, in things that we might love about the things in this world, we do all have access to Almighty God. We have access to, we have been granted, we've been given permission because we have been forgiven of our sins. We have been made holy. We have been made holy. It goes back to the word saints. We have been set apart. And because that we have been set apart, we all have been granted access to God. Hebrews talks about how we can come before the throne of grace, the place in which grace is given. We share that. We share that access. And so when you look in the context here, he's talking about the Jews and the Gentiles, people who were enemies, people who didn't like one another, people who were coming from different backgrounds, and he's saying, no, we all have access to God the Father. What an amazing thing to consider, that we can come before the throne of God, the King above all kings, the Lord of lords, and pray and seek guidance and unload and pray for one another and pray for patience. And that's when God goes, meet Sister Cantankerous. Here's where you can work on your patience. That's part of that, though, the one spirit in which we all share. And so we have this one Spirit that we've been given, the Spirit of promise that we've given when we were received it as the gift of the Holy Spirit, when we were immersed into Christ in Acts chapter 2. And seeing that again, and we were sealed with them. We were given the Holy Spirit. We have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is what allows us to have access to the Father, in which we have been given by God as well. And so let me look at one last point here. One last point. And let's turn to Ephesians chapter 4. I know there are other places in which the Spirit is talked about, but this is the last one that I wanted to focus on. Ephesians chapter 4, let's start in verse 25. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25. It says, "Therefore, laying aside falsehood, speak truth, each one of you with his neighbor. For we are members of one another." Here, he's like, here's the discussion points in which you can have. Verse 26, "But be angry and yet do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not give the devil an opportunity. Verse 28, "He who steals must steal no longer, but rather he must labor, performing with his own hands what is good, so that he will have something to share with one who has need. Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification." Now, going back, remember, this is going back up to verse 25, and the context is we are members of one another. So he's talking about, the context he's talking about is the church here, us. Not Sunday services church, but he's just talking about the church family, the many members that are part of the family, the ones that should interact with one another throughout the week. He's not just talking about when we come together on Sunday, but this is a daily life, a daily walk in which we have, in which we are practicing these things. So we are members of one another. I just want us to be reminded of this context. Now at verse 29, "So let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth toward one another, but only such a word as is good for edification according to the need of the moment, so that it will give grace to those who hear." So then in verse 30, he says, "Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption." That's why I wanted to point out that idea of, do we consciously think about the sealing of the Holy Spirit that we possess, that we have? That we have the Holy Spirit, that we've all been given, those that have been immersed into Christ. Going back to Acts chapter 2, "Repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins in the name of Jesus Christ, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." And so part of what Paul is talking about here is keeping that in mind so that you don't grieve, you don't hurt the Holy Spirit that was with you. Well, how do we do that? James, how are we grieving the Holy Spirit? Well, we reread the things that we just read, and then we read after it. Let's look at this again. Look at verse 26. "Be angry and yet do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not give the devil an opportunity. He who steals must steal no longer, but rather he must labor, performing with his own hands what is good, so that he will have something to share with one who has need." Verse 29, "Let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth towards one another, but only," I'm adding that towards one another just to keep the flow of what Paul's talking about here, "but only such a word as is good for edification according to the need of the moment, so that it will give grace to those who hear." Now listen, this is not just a verse that is something we kind of take out and try to apply in different ways and different manners. Paul is talking specifically about these things here in which cause the grief of the Holy Spirit. "Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, just as God in Christ also has forgiven you." So when we see this idea of "do not grieve the Holy Spirit," oftentimes we're like, what does that mean? I don't understand what that has to, I just don't, how do we grieve the Holy Spirit? The Holy Spirit has been given to all of us. At the end of Ephesians chapter 2, turn with me to Ephesians chapter 2, and let me read something here again for you. He's talking about the body. He's talking about God's household at the end of verse 19. Look at verse 20, Ephesians 2. Having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together is growing into a holy temple in the Lord. What does that mean? Verse 22. In whom you are also, individual members, us that are being built together into a dwelling of God in the Spirit. So while we individually have been given the Holy Spirit, man, that's twice. Let's not hope for three. We collectively, when we are together collectively, we have the Spirit of God with us. And so, and that's not just talking about here on Sunday. When we are with one another, if the Spirit is with us, then the Spirit, when we are with one another, the Spirit is with us all, for those who are in Christ. So, when we become angry, when we are bitter, when we choose unwholesome words against one another, a fellow brother or sister in Christ, which has the seal of the Holy Spirit, we're grieving and hurting him. He feels that pain that is coming from one another, that strife, that anger, allowing the devil an opportunity. Have you ever been around someone who you know is making a bad decision and you can't, there's nothing really you can do about it, but it just hurts? It just hurts you because you know they're making a bad decision. You know that what they're doing is going to hurt them. The Holy Spirit is looking and we're making these decisions and he knows that's going to hurt us. And it brings him grief. It brings him pain and sorrow. We all have the one Spirit. Going back to Ephesians 4, one body, one Spirit. And so notice, verse 29, let no unwholesome word proceed from your mouth, but only such a word as is good for edification according to the need. So that it will, the translators supply the word of the moment, and I think the idea is there, according to the need. So the need might be different in this time, and the need might be different in this time. But guess what? God wants us to be thinkers. God wants us to be conscious of our surroundings. He wants us to be conscious of people around us, of their feelings, of their emotions, of their problems, the things that they struggle. God wants us to be conscious of that so that we don't rattle off something flippant that discourages the person in the time and the situation that they find themselves in. Notice the idea that we need to find out more about them. Guess what? We need to talk about them. We need to talk to them. We need to share with them. We need to relate to them. We need to find these commonalities that we have in Scripture and then these things that we have in common with one another outside so that we can then talk to one another and choose the best words to encourage and build them up. Going back to Ephesians 2, because we're all being built up into a holy temple for God. And so we need to build one another up. And it goes back to Peter's living stones. Because we're all living stones. Sometimes a living stone can get a chip on the shoulder because of something someone says. So we want to, all of these things... the beauty of God's word is that it illustrates these things. God illustrates these things in all different manners and ways. He talks about living stones. He talks about a holy temple. He talks about a building. He talks about a body, members of the body, so that we can understand, how we're supposed to work together. Something that I think every dad does to their kids or every big brother does to a younger brother.
Why are you hitting yourself? Why are you hitting yourself? Why are you hitting yourself?
Well, you grab that arm, right? And I think some of the Kennedy, I think, does it to Cody. Cody, does he do that to you? She was just laughing. Yeah, I thought so. And, you know, you grab their arm. Why are you hitting yourself? Why are you hitting yourself? You know, because obviously you're doing it. The point is it's ridiculous to hit yourself. You know, if you walked in, someone's like, you know, smacked yourself. You're like, you all right, man? Yeah, I'm fine. You just smacked yourself in the face. Don't worry, I just got an argument. You know, you'd walk away concerned for that guy's well-being, right? Well, in a certain way, when the body of Christ comes together, we shouldn't be hitting ourselves. We shouldn't be slapping ourselves, because we are one body and we have one Spirit, which unites us, that we've been given, that we all have as a seal, saying that we are God's children and that we have been redeemed. We have a pledge, and God is on our heart with His name on it, that we're His. And so, yes, we want to be diligent, as we're talking about in Ephesians, to preserve the unity, to preserve the unity in the Spirit, in the bond of peace. Go back, read this passage, and read these things, and notice how Paul connects all these things through this letter. And that these facts are found, these seven things are found throughout the rest of the entirety of this letter. And he's wanting to know the Ephesians church that you are united in Christ and you all have these spiritual blessings and you all need to work together to preserve the unity that you have been given, that you have. Maybe you're struggling with someone in the church. Maybe you have kind of a disagreement. Maybe there's been an argument or something, or maybe you're just not feeling right. You know, sometimes something's said and you're like, I don't know if I feel right about it. And you go and you talk about it and you find out, well, that person didn't mean anything by it. It was just a misunderstanding. But don't let that sit. Don't let that stay. Don't let your anger go down. Don't let your anger. We need to talk to one another, communicate to one another, because it's only then that we can build up one another in the way that God wants us to build up one another. As I mentioned in the beginning of this talking about the letter, we went back and we talked about the saints, and we talked about how the Holy Spirit of promise was given to them after they believed the message. And we went back to Acts chapter 2, and this is talking about their salvation. Talking about their salvation with those men of Israel said, what do we do, Peter? What do? We are guilty of crucifying the Son of God. That's probably if you think about it, you know, in our life, the way we look at things, spectrum of life, that's got to be one of the pretty bad sins, right? Even though God looks at sin in all the same way, we might go, well, there's a white lie, and then there's crucifying the Son of God. But guess what happens to those people? They can be saved too. So if you're sitting here and you're like, James, I don't know, you don't know what I've done in my life, I wouldn't even want to discuss those things with you. It's like, well, you don't have to discuss those things with you. God already knows what they are, and His blood can cover it as well. You can be forgiven through the blood of Christ, and you are forgiven of your sins. You believe, you hear the message, you repent, you're immersed into Christ, you receive the forgiveness of sins, and then you receive the one Spirit that unites us all, and that is a seal of our redemption, where we will be with God in one day. It is a promise. If you have a need, we offer you the invitation to come forward as we're going to stand and sing. You can come up here to this front row. But please, or just talk to one of us, talk to myself, talk to Steve, who was up here with the announcements, talk to John, who did the Lord's Supper, and talk to any one of us here that are here. That if you have questions about what you heard today or about what we talked about, please don't leave without talking to us. Or if you need some more prayer for something, please let us know. But let us stand and let us sing.
Yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. On that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share. When the chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, yonder, I'll be there.
Thank you very much, James, for an excellent lesson once again, and we are so glad to have everyone here this morning, and we've got a full house almost, and it's good to see that. So, if you are visiting with us, and I know we have several visitors, if you would fill out a card and give it to one of us, or put it in the brown collection box back there, and stay around for a minute, and let's get to say hi to you. We are so excited. We have another family that wishes to identify with us, and Kevin and Tanya Dodd family, and their girls Avery, Claire, and Emma, who come to us from the Austin area, and we are so excited that they have decided to join us here and work with us. And so, if you haven't met them already, go ahead and meet them afterwards. So, we welcome you. So, we have. We have the bulletin back there. If you did not receive it electronically, it's on the back table. It's got a lot of things, a lot of information for us. And so grab one if you haven't got that. If there is nothing else, we do have worship services tonight at 6:00, and we ask you to join us for that as well. So if there's nothing else, let's go ahead and bow in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for this time together, and we praise and honor your name, Lord. We are so thankful for your church and that we can call ourselves Christians. And we pray, Lord, that we will continue to always try and build one another up here as a body. And we ask you to be with those that that need your help, that are struggling with various things, various issues in life, and let us let them find hope in you and through the love and concern through each one of us, that we can help them along their journey. Lord, we ask you to be with those that are traveling and to keep them safe. Lord, we are so grateful for our new families and individuals who have decided to join us here in the past few weeks as we work here at Parker. As we try and grow in our relationship with you and with one another, we ask you to bless their families and those individuals as they seek to serve you. Lord, we ask you to continue to be with us this week as we depart here, and we thank you for the sacrifice of your Son to allow us the opportunity to spend eternity in heaven with you. And Lord, we offer this prayer
through your Son's name. Amen.